since John introduced me as in terms of the length of our friendship, it occurred to me that I first learned to practice meditation in 1971. And for me, there's a very linear path from that event to being here today. I've been fascinated the whole time between about the connection of the mind and the body. Unfortunately, we had a French philosopher in the 17th century that misled us for a while. Some of you might think that you really don't see many patients with chronic pain or fatigue. That's the impression that some of my colleagues with whom I talk have and have repeated to me from time to time. But we know from the past two speakers that these are common medical problems and that the incidence rates are high. So how is it that a psychologist or a social worker or a nurse practitioner, whomever, might think that it's a less frequent problem? Well, one is that we live in the beehive state. It's normal to be very busy, and fatigue is a natural result of busyness, and so I think a lot of people just consider fatigue to be a part of life. Another possibility is that the person has seen a previous provider and physicians for a long time have been misdiagnosing both of these conditions. In fact, we have patients with CFS who have been to see three or four physicians before being accurately diagnosed. There's also the fear of being misunderstood. I have never seen, as a patient or socially, somebody with CFS who was not an overachiever or a type A personality. Now, you should never say never, and so it might happen to me tomorrow. But in 25 years, every CFS patient that I have seen fits this category. And so that's very much a part of their identity. And what they don't want to be perceived at is, you know, somebody who's a sluggard or... so they put on a good face. And then the fourth is denial, that when we start to experience these symptoms, we're not liking what we're intuiting in the future. And so... we start to shield off the information so that we don't have to pay attention to it. There's also problems with underdiagnosis from providers. A lot of family practitioners misdiagnose these as depression or anxiety or function of family dynamics. And I can remember the first referral that I got from a physician, and I thought, oh, I didn't realize that my work with CFS was becoming very widely known. And then I found out that they referred the person to me because they thought that the patient had a somatoform disorder. In other words, that they were just somaticizing. This was all in your head. Of course, the truth of it is that it is in your head because that's where the center of the nervous system is. But and part of the problem in doing research in this area has been that both of these illnesses have been kind of a garbage can diagnosis where physicians and mental health providers have used a term because they haven't been able to figure something else out. The area of poorly understood syndromes, you know, is not a contemporary phenomenon. So while both fibromyalgia and CFS are very poorly understood, other things that once fit in that category include multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's disease, lupus, and a bunch of others. But when I was in my short tenure as a pre-med student, 1966, the immune system wasn't even in our textbooks. And the extent of knowledge that I was exposed to about fatigue was to say that, well, energy is created by mitochondria, and that's, you know, a one-day lecture. And so, as Dr. Bateman said, you know, things haven't progressed too far, because fatigue is still poorly covered in medical schools. The offer organization has now put on 6 conferences for providers across our 10-year period, and we're slowly starting to educate people, at least in this regional area, as to what is involved. So, as my previous speakers have described, you know, there are a range of subsets that are included here. And Cindy put up this slide just to give you an idea of how many alternatives there are. One of the reasons that we're focusing on fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue for this conference is because not only are they two things that we specialize in, but also because they're perhaps some of the hardest examples of both to work with. So fibromyalgia is oftentimes mistreated with narcotics, and as Dr. Smith indicated, you know, it's a form of pain that responds poorly to opioids. And as far as fatigue goes, most physicians have no idea where to even start with it. So we have heard a little bit about what chronic fatigue syndrome is, and that there are subsets of pain. A little bit about fibromyalgia descriptively, and the diagnosis for these two conditions. Cindy went over both the 94 definition and the 2000, and I just want to make an additional point, and that is that the 1994 definition was a research definition, but not a clinical definition. And even with the 2000, we really don't have, as Dr. Bateman said, good laboratory tests for it. And so these definitions are sometimes played fast and loose with. Oh, I want to go back to this. And with CFS, there's a huge ongoing debate, discussion, argument about how to change the name, because fatigue barely captures it. And we've now appended an additional name to it that most people can't even pronounce. And the patients and providers aren't any happier than they were before. We have to find a biomarker before I think we can really adequately provide a name to that. So these diagnostic criteria are certainly a place to start. And hopefully more and more physicians and mental health providers are becoming familiar with the definitions for diagnosis. As you can see from the first two speakers, and as they pointed out, there's a tremendous overlap here. There's also a tremendous breadth. And so we're now really talking about what is called a super system or psychoneuroimmunology. And my personal idea about these two illnesses is that we're really not going to have a definitive understanding of them until we understand what wellness is. Because I think these illnesses will be found to really cover the entire range of physiology. So how do we treat this as mental health professionals? The first thing I want to say is that if you read the literature, it constantly mentions cognitive behavioral therapy. And you might think that this is therefore the domain of just one subset of mental health providers. That came about because of a few accidents of history. One is that research favors protocols, and CBT is an orientation toward psychology that is based in protocols often. The other thing is that the early research on these two illnesses focused on symptoms, and that CBT is a very effective choice with some other areas that psychologists and mental health providers have involved themselves in the medical world, such as smoking cessation and other things of that sort. But illness is just one of life's experiences. And when I tell people that half of my practice is dealing with people who have one illness or another, it's as if I was doing two different kinds of therapy. But I think if you listen to an audio tape of one of my therapy sessions, you might be hard-pressed to know whether this is a person that we would consider well or a person who has CFS or fibromyalgia, because basically we're talking about the same person and the same life challenges. So whether you're a Jungian therapist or a object relations oriented person or attachment based theory or a Bowen family practitioner, the orientation that you come from does not limit what you can do with these illnesses. And actually, as you're going to see, the interventions that are appropriate for these two illnesses vary with time, and myself being what I would consider a depth therapist, I find myself doing CBT work, you know, at certain times because that's what's called for. So who are these people that we've been referring to today? I've already talked about them as overachievers. And there's a big argument in psychology literature about whether these are illnesses that result from secondary gain. In other words, the person is so busy that they don't know how to cut back and they need the body to give them an excuse or to do it for them. And we're now, with science, you know, able to reject this as a detracting comment. Most of the people with these two illnesses have either lost their careers or had to scale back and give up some of their dreams for what they wanted to accomplish in their careers. They've lost friends because people can't depend on them to participate in the activities that they're invited to on any kind of a regular basis. And oftentimes have lost pastimes and passions. And in some cases, even family members. The only thing that I know that has split families as much as sexual orientation is illnesses that are poorly understood. And there can be rejection from parents and siblings. In fact, I know one CFS patient who's on support, financial support from the government because her father doesn't believe that it's a real illness. And the one thing that really holds this whole population together is an impatience to get back to life. So if you're struggling with whether you're seeing a case of depression or one of these two illnesses, this is one of the best differentiating criteria. So much so that chronic fatigue is kind of characterized by a cyclical pattern. People will get better, and then they overdo it and crash, then they start to get better, and they crash, and they start to get better, and they crash. I've never seen that happen in depression. Depression can fluctuate, but its fluctuations are more tied to moods or emotion-laden events as opposed to doing too much. So while losing your health can certainly make you depressed, I wouldn't say that any of my patients that I can think of would be mistaken as a depressed person, except for by somebody who really doesn't understand the two illnesses. So anytime that you're sick for 6 months or more, and you don't know why, and you don't know how it's going to turn out, is going to provide a major disruption to one's sense of self. You know, all of a sudden, who I am is open to question. And the result is grief, confusion, and anger. And all of these can come in wholesale quantities. And thus, identity is disrupted. Who we are, the cohesive thread that ties us together becomes tangled and torn. So psychologists have applied stage theory to a number of different aspects of behavior and life, and I think that it's very helpful in thinking about chronic illnesses. So I'm going to talk today about a stage theory that basically includes four stages. The first is crisis, the second is stabilization, the third is resolution, and the fourth is integration. So the relevancy of using this is that, first of all, it helps you understand where the patient is and why the CFS patient that's sitting in front of you is so different than the last CFS patient that you saw, or the same for fibromyalgia. It also helps you to know where to start with your interventions, because as I'm trying to describe this, I'm going to point out that some interventions are more appropriate at one stage than another. Mistake of going with an intervention too early is that the patient might be non-compliant or sabotaged. And this has happened too often, such that chronic fatigue syndrome patients are oftentimes regarded in the medical community as a pain in the rear, you know, that it's just too difficult because, you know, they don't want to do anything that they're told to do. Well, the first stage, the crisis stage, is such a shock. You know, all of a sudden we've lost something that we have taken for granted our whole life. So people with CFS in this first stage have oftentimes been misdiagnosed or have been diagnosed and not given any adequate treatment. People will sometimes be accurately diagnosed, not like the news, and go doctor shopping. And the emotional experience during this time is of surprise, bewilderment, denial, attachment to the life that they're trying to hold on to but is disappearing as it slips through their fingers, and anger. And people are looking for a magic bullet. There's got to be a pill out there somewhere. And I think this is especially true in the United States, where people watch so much TV and there are any number of pharmaceutical products that are always being advertised on TV. Surely one of those must be what would help us. And during this time, because of the factors I just described, there's usually going to be a worsening of the illness or a flare that will perhaps abate slightly. But until a person is accurately diagnosed, has received some early medical treatment, and has started to get past the idea that this is going to change tomorrow, that they're going to be in this cycle. So treatment during the phase one, and this applies to CFS and fibro equally, is that you're basically dealing with trauma and crisis management. You know, this is much like somebody who has just been through a terrible event, and they're in shock or just post-shock. And so the very basic thing to begin with is to build a therapeutic alliance, because there's a chance that they are suspicious of providers having been misdiagnosed or been told that it's in their head or that the provider doesn't know what's happening. So sometimes in phase one, these people can be a little bit difficult to, you know, connect with initially. And I think it helps to give people an overview of what's about to happen so that they understand that their present experience isn't going to continue forever, even as the illnesses continue, and that there are going to be different objectives and practices as the person goes along. And if the person isn't resistant to some of what you're saying, then they probably are no longer in phase one. So in phase two, which we could call stabilization, the person starts to experience the fact that the normal process of starting a task, feeling a sense of accomplishment, finishing the task and taking pride in that, being able to move on to the next, this normal process of intention, engagement, feedback, and refocusing is being almost universally interfered with. So a person who used to vacuum their house twice a week finds that vacuuming half of it takes most of one day, or that they can't even stand in front of the sink long enough to do the dishes from the previous meal. And all of a sudden, that good feeling that comes with accomplishing things drops right out of one's life. There is a sense of regaining some control because the doctor may have started with the basics and given them some idea that there are things that can be addressed. I know that Dr. Bateman and Dr. Smith both, in their intakes, look at sleep as one of the first things to consider. And there are things that a patient can do in terms of sleep hygiene, adjusting their bedtime, and even if they don't come back having successfully completed the task immediately, the fact that they're chipping away at it or that they have something they can focus on gives them just a tiny bit of that sense of control. And in stage two, with the stabilization process, means that for the first time they're thinking of this as a process of adapting and dealing with imposed limitations. Interestingly, what happens in stage two is that as soon as you grasp that you have to cope and adapt with everything, how long it takes you to take a shower, what it means to get dressed, how long it takes to gather things together to leave for an event, as you start to realize that everything requires adaptation and coping, then all of a sudden there's this, why me? You know, this is going to take too much. I'm going to lose too much time adapting and coping. I'm not going to have enough of the real stuff. And in the stabilization phase, the person has no idea that basically human beings are adapting all the time. A high school student goes off to college and goes through a major adaptation. If they graduate from college and go into the workplace, there's another major adaptation. For those of you who are married, any questions about... So stabilization is also a time when people will first reach out to other people, because in that first stage, the crisis stage, it's kind of self-sufficiency, hunkered down, nobody understands. And at this point, the illness has already gotten so lonely that they're wanting to connect, and ideally with somebody who will understand, because this is an impossibly difficult illness, or these are impossibly difficult illnesses, to describe to somebody who's hearing about it for the first time. And there's also this idea of chronicity, and it becomes an intolerable idea. And people who aren't in treatment will oftentimes slip into despair at this time. Despair is an emotion where you have emotions that are present and you project them into the future. So you're feeling hopeless and you're assuming that nothing is ever going to change. And that's despair. So the treatment during this phase is to encourage self-observation and insight. The person with these two illnesses needs to start to realize that physicians aren't going to be able to do the entire job of treating them, that these are two illnesses that involve substantial self-management. And to self-manage, we need to know what's happening and what we're capable of, and so that insight and self-observation becomes essential. The therapist can help a person during this stage overcome psychological defenses, particularly denial. This is something that has to be done in a gentle way, because defenses are something that operate to our advantage, initially at least. And also characterological interventions, in other words, our personalities. One person who recovered from CFS was asked how it occurred, and he said, well, in a sentence, I just basically needed to reinvent my entire personality. So type A people have a big challenge to contend with. You know, people who are perfectionists find that they can't afford to be. And this is the stage when a person can actually first start dealing with the feelings as opposed to just having them. So to be able to express feelings, to understand what they are, to know what significance they have, and to be able to move on without getting stuck in a particular feeling. And the whole grieving process is something that can happen best, usually, with the help of a professional. Also, this is a time for clarification of values. So if you can only do 1/10 of what you did before becoming sick, you're going to have more satisfaction if you do things that are most important to you. And to be able to look at the variety of activities and commitments you have and start to prioritize them gives a person the feeling of control that at least they can try and make choices such that their time is well spent. This is also a time where family relations and friendship relations are, for the first time, susceptible of a positive process rather than just a disarray of loss and misunderstanding. And so helping people understand the relationship process is very much a matter of phase two. And sometimes couples interventions when the person is married. So phase three is the resolution stage. We've had crisis, stabilization, and this is resolution. Resolution is when we start to integrate the disease or illness as a part of our life rather than an event that we're going to escape from. Okay? And so that means we're looking increasingly for where can I have control? What can I do? Okay, so if I can't go to the film festival this year because I can't stand in line, what's an alternative? Well, the Sundance channel on TV. I'll watch last year's movies. Or I can go to one movie if I take a little camp stool with me so that I can sit while I'm in line. Those kinds of adaptations bring a growing sense of control. And these are two illnesses that result in a lot of stigmatization, and helping the person learn how to deal with that, because the rest of the population isn't changing very fast, is essential, because as long as the stigmatization is active and a part of our experience, the shame alters the entire rest of the emotional process. And hopefully the person during this phase three transition is pathologizing themselves less, and that results in increased self-esteem. And a very important part of phase three is an increase of tolerance for chronicity and ambiguity. And here's where you find the black and white thinkers and the people who see shades of gray falling into two very different categories. And a black and white thinker in this stage is going to have a profound change as they develop actually a different capacity of cognitive activity. Also, part of stage three is developing a respect for suffering. People with this illness, people who have lost their health, are not the only people who are suffering. Suffering is widespread. In fact, it has been said that suffering is the basic characteristic of life for most people. So to be able to see ourselves not as a special subpopulation, but just that this is our challenge and other people have other challenges, becomes less isolating. And all of these changes that I'm describing now start to kind of fit together into the necessary ingredients for creativity. And as a person either develops a capacity for creativity or recaptures that, that becomes then a fertile field that can be worked under different conditions with less energy and so on and so forth. So the treatment during this time is a development, continuation of insight and grief work, grappling with the existential dilemma, who am I, you know, why has this happened to me? And the development of qualities that have been described previously as self-actualization. Abraham Maslow's work here is becomes the focus of much of one's time. Phase four, the resolution stage, is basically when the illness just becomes part of our self, and it is one of many descriptors. So I can describe myself as a psychologist. I'm a father, I'm a husband, I'm a skier, I'm a whitewater river rafter, and I have chronic fatigue syndrome, you know, that kind of integration such as that. So The arc of these four stages starts to make sense. When you get to the stage four, you can look back and see the rest of it in perspective. And the integration of who we were beforehand and who we are becoming starts to integrate, and we see it just as kind of a progression rather than as a pre-post disruption. And phase four is the time that reconstituted relationships start to appear and are maintainable. And a broadened sense of meaning starts to be a regular part of life. One person who had CFS said that it was the worst thing that had ever happened to them, and it was the best teacher they've ever had. So the Asian cultures are a little bit different, but in the West, you know, we're the culture of Don Quixote, and we have adventures and aspirations that we're moving toward, and life, if you're not depressed or traumatized, usually has a sense of quest about it. And in stage four, that starts to return, a quest for a full life. So how do we, as therapists, treat a person at this point? Well, the primary thing is the process of mirroring and being able to help that person see what they're accomplishing and how they're changing, and to be able to put all of this together in a fresh self-concept, and to support their exploration and experience of free will. So, you know, oftentimes my patients will say, well, I can't do that. Thanksgiving has always been at our house. Or, if I did that, my dad would never invite me on a vacation again. And so we find that our free will is really governed by all kinds of misbeliefs and conditioning. And once we've done the work of stage one, two, and three, we're really able to test illusions that have been sacred up until that point. And the person then starts to build this into a narrative as if they were able to tell their story around the campfire or write a book. It takes on an arc. And the development of meaning becomes deeply anchored and lived on a regular basis. People who have had this illness for some time will sometimes report that their friendships are actually more stable and meaningful than they were before the illness. Some of the casual friendships dropped out of their life. The ones that are developed during the illness process are being kind of forged, you know, the way that steel is, and you bang on a friendship long enough, and if it endures, it's becoming a strong friendship. And families will sometimes pull together in a way that not only is the person with the illness being accepted for who they are with those limitations, but there's a greater understanding of the differentiation within the family. Healthy families tend to be well differentiated, and sometimes illness is the process that pushes a family to that. And for the people who go back to work or continue to work or increase their work hours, there's always some adaptation required, because no matter how high-functioning a person becomes in stage four, there's the necessity to protect and maintain that. And if you go back to your foolish ways, you'll probably relapse. So I want to talk about specific treatments now that I've put this in a context. Group psychotherapy is highly recommend it for these people because, first of all, it deals with the isolation. It gives you a sense of normalization. It can address the shame that some people develop, and it can promote insight and cohesion, emotional expression, and interpersonal learning. Pacing is the big conundrum with these illnesses, because what most people think of as pacing doesn't even come close to what's required by the illness. And so it's far more complicated, it's not intuitive, and it requires things that most people don't do, such as scheduling rests. And it might happen that you actually have to get so far as, okay, I'm going down for a 15-minute rest at 10 o'clock, 1 o'clock, and 4 o'clock. It might be that specific, for 15 minutes, for example. The difficult first step is to, what is my baseline? So one of my patients who was a star volleyball player at BYU and kind of the winning factor on their team, when she got past the stage one and was trying to address the deconditioning that had occurred, thought that what she could start out with was about three times as much as what she was actually capable of. It almost takes some kind of an expert, whether it's a physician, a mental health worker, or a friend who's had the illness, or a support group, to find that baseline. And the people who are still in a deprivation framework, you know, in other words, oh, life was great, then I came down with these illnesses and look what I've got now. We tend to counter deprivation, you know, by the extra effort to replace. And that feeds the cycle of improvement and crashing. So as you're trying to find what you're capable of, if you can feel okay at the end of the day, don't assume that you can do more tomorrow. Try and maintain that for 3 days. And if you can maintain it for 3 days, that might be actually something that you can build from, but you'll probably find that on the second day you're feeling worse and then you need to drop it. Fortunately, both of the first two speakers talked about treating sleep, and I won't pause on the details here, but psychologists have the advantage, therapists have the advantage over physicians, in that if we're seeing somebody for an hour or a week and on a regular basis, we have far more time to go into the details of pacing and changing sleep patterns as compared to a physician who is seeing the patient once a month or once every 3 months. So this is these are two things that typically fall to a therapist if one is involved. Managing pain certainly starts with medications, and we saw in both Cindy's talk and Lee's that there's so much more, and actually recognizing the non-pharmacological interventions and being able to change to adopt them is oftentimes best done in group psychotherapy. The cognitive problems that come with these two illnesses are notorious. Anybody that has fibro or CFS will refer to the fibro fog or the CFS fog, and it's oftentimes the most debilitating part of the illness. People who can kind of work their way around having more fatigue become terrified at the thought of not being able to function cognitively at the same level. In fact, my experience in treating people is that if you're trying to pace yourself and trying to gradually increase your levels of activity, that the cognitive sense of oneself is more accurate than the level of fatigue, because fatigue is a kind of a more fuzzy barometer, and the cognitive is much more sharply defined. And so with all of my patients, I'm constantly working with them to become more self-aware about their cognitive functioning and how to improve it. These are some important ways that you can address fog. While there is a drug or two that can be helpful, these are the things that really make the difference. Deconditioning becomes a really big problem the longer one is sick, and is probably one of the most difficult things to deal with. I'm not even going to pause to say much there. But the problem of measuring ourselves, how much is too much, how much is enough, this becomes a big question in the psychotherapy that I do with my patients, because it's an individualized measurement and it's hard to know how to use it reliably. Dr. Smith mentioned briefly four principles of health outcomes, and I want to underscore these: an internal locus of control, a sense of connectedness, a sense of purpose and meaning, and a sense of hope. Anything that contributes to those four are going to improve outcomes.